Dianne, the horticulturist for the city of Reno. I'm here in Paradise Park at the community garden, and we're going to work a little bit today on bed prep. A lot of you are starting to think about your garden. Some of you have thought about it before, and they probably froze, I would guess. The general rule of thumb is that you wait until the snow's off a pea vine. My rule of thumb is around June 10th. I mean, that's my best date to know that I'm not going to get frost. Otherwise, you're going to be uncovering and covering plants every night. So it's something that you have to think about. We had such a cold spring that those of you that planted early are probably sorry for it. But I wanted to talk a little bit about bed prep, bed selection, and those kinds of things. And then we're going to plant a salsa garden and then show you some easy maintenance to keep it so that you don't have to spend a lot of time on your hands and knees pulling weeds. There are things in general horticulture that you can do that will prevent weed growth, the chemicals you can put down, but in a vegetable garden, can't do that. You don't want to put down anything that the plants will uptake and that you have to eat later on. So I'm going to show you some kind of organic ways to keep the weeds out of the way. So the first thing, when you're doing bed selection, this is imported soil in a raised bed, and these I think by far are superior for Northern Nevada, and that's because you can control what kind of soil was put in here. Now, I'm not really happy with this soil. It's kind of rocky. There's a lot of organic matter. There's a lot of leaves and stuff in here that haven't broken down. But as long as you know what you're starting with, it's okay to have a little extra leaf. You can see all this leafy matter here that's dry and intact. So what you want to do is, if you know you've got a lot of this organic matter that hasn't broken down, you're going to add an extra source of nitrogen. And I'm talking about, you know, if you want to do organic, then you got to have some high quality manure with a lot of nitrogen in it. And the nitrogen does not feed the plants. What it does is it feeds the bacteria in the soil that would normally take up the nutrients that is coming out of the organic matter that's breaking down. And then those bacteria and fungi that break down this organic matter end up dying themselves, and then the nutrients become available to the plant. So you have to feed both the bacteria and the fungi and the plants when you have this much organic matter that hasn't broken down in the soil. So that's an issue, but we've got it. It's fairly light soil. It's kind of sandy. It'll drain easily, so you don't have to worry too much about the soil getting waterlogged. The problem with the sandy soil, though, is that you're going to lose water, so you're going to have to water a little bit more often. And we're going to apply a mulch that will keep the moisture in and will also keep the weeds down. So first things first, if you look at the surface of this bed, you'll see that it's not level. And so if you're watering this, even if you're drip irrigating, you're going to have things kind of sheeting off to the corner. And then there's weeds in here. And you will have weed seeds germinating after you plant and start to water again, but you don't want to start with big weeds in the first place. So we're going to get that out. So I'm going to start working, you know, bending over and taking care of things and getting rid of stuff. And then I'll be back to show you how to plant.
Nutrition can lead to great things. Find out how a healthy lifestyle can help your child succeed.
Yes, ready, ready.
Oh, come on, Randy. Animal shelter, here I come. And no, I'm not crazy or emotionally damaged. That's a stereotype. I just belong to a total loser. I'm a good dog. So if you want a pet, adopt. And if you see Randy, tell him he dropped his wallet.
Hi, welcome back to the program. Now that I've got this mostly level and weed-free, I've left a few volunteers in here because this bed belongs to someone. If you're interested in volunteering in the garden, we always need volunteers. We also have a waiting list for the beds, but next year, if you're interested in having your own little garden plot, you can contact me. The number is 334-2270. But right now, let's get back to what's going on with this bed. First off, let's talk about the dimensions of a raised bed. Whether you've got a raised bed that's high enough so that you don't have to hunch over, or one that's a little bit lower because you've got smaller plants in it and you don't really need a big raised bed. One of the key factors is you don't want anything that you can't reach into the center of, okay? You don't want to end up having, you know, to defeat the whole purpose of having an easily manageable space if you have to get up on your hands and knees on top and work on things, like it, make it awkward. So that's one of the things we're thinking about designing a bed. Usually the standard is 4 to 5 feet across at any given point. So now I wet this bed down a little bit. You know, watering by hand is difficult. I watered it by hand for a while, and you can see that even though I did, there's a lot of really dry soil in here. And I don't worry too much about planting into dry soil because I'm going to go ahead and water again. But if it's not been wet down really deep, if you're looking at as you dig, you don't find any moist soil down deep, you might want to spend a little bit more time watering beforehand. As I dig down here, I found some dry soil, and now the deeper stuff is moist. And so I'm not too concerned about that. The top layer is dry because we've had some nice warm weather. The lower level is wet because there's nothing really drawing moisture out from the surface except for the temperature. So not a big concern. So, and look, I found a little volunteer. It looks like a squash, but it's sadly not going to make it. So now what I've selected is a group of plants for what I call a salsa garden. It's kind of a theme garden. I have tomatoes. This is Campbell's 33. This is an heirloom variety tomato. Heirloom variety tomatoes are non-hybrid, which means if you save the seed from the plant you had the first year, you'll have a true breeding plant, for the next season. And that's nice because then you don't have to continue to buy seeds, and you don't have to worry about the odd plants that come from a hybrid plant that they segregate out the next year and they don't breed true to type. And then I have a jalapeno pepper, and some onions. These happen to be scallions, but I like scallions. If I had real onions, I'd use those. And then, because, you know, not all salsa has peppers in it, I've got some basil for some other types of salsas. And there's two kinds of basil. This is called lettuce leaf basil, and this is called giant Genovese. You can see the difference in the two. The leaves are enormous here on the lettuce leaf basil. The difference between the two is the flavor. There's more flavor per, you know, square inch of leaf than there is in this one here than there is in this one. And then this is a little bit of Siamese basil. It has very, very strong flavor. Small, very small leaf plants. Obviously got a little big for their containers. But this, the fragrance on these is just amazing. And it's said that basil actually repels squirrels. I don't know if I believe that, but we're going to try it. So that's what it looks like. I'm going to go ahead and talk really quick specifically about planting. When you look at this tomato plant, it's gotten a little big for the pot. And that's fine. The concern is not that. The concern is when you plant it in the ground, is it going to lodge? And with tomato plants, you can actually plant them deeper. You can plant this plant all the way up to here, you know, to these first leaves right here. And it will root from the stem, and you will have a better, stronger plant, okay? So I don't worry too much about buying oversized plants. So specifically with tomatoes, if I'm going to start, usually, traditionally, they need about 3 feet spread. So 3 feet means you're going to plant a foot and a half from the edge to wherever you're going to plant. And in general, that's kind of, for a woman, it's a little bit bigger than just from your elbow to your fingertips. So I'm just going to go a little bit further out. So you don't need any measuring implements. And then I'm going to dig a really, really deep hole in here, because this plant's going to go in pretty deep. And now, in general, you don't really want to disturb things in the soil very much, because then it increases the number of weeds that you're incorporating back into the soil. So just dig the holes that you can. If you've got really, really tough soil, and like clayey soil, something with a lot of clay in it, Then you might need to rototill in some organic matter so that you can actually work it. But this sandy stuff, you know, I'm just trying not to disturb the surface as much as possible now that I've gotten rid of the weeds. And then I used to preach that you don't need to mess up the root balls. And since then, I've read some research, some real research from some scientists that say it is actually better to do that. So what you want to do is get your fingers in here and butterfly this open. And you can see there's not a lot of roots in the center. And what you want to do is make it so that these roots get in contact with the new soil that it's going into. Otherwise, they just kind of stay and grow into the old soil. That's nicer soil. They like that better. So you want to kind of give them, encourage them to move out. You plant this in, and then all of a sudden your overgrown plant is fairly manageable in size. Now there are two plants on here. I'm not going to worry too much about that. They'll compete with each other, but I think they'll mostly be able to produce. This tomato plant, Campbell's 33, is the original Campbell's tomato soup tomato. So it'll be fun to see what comes of this. When you're dealing with other plants, if you don't specifically know, the rule of thumb is that you plant them so that they're sitting at the same level in the ground that the soil level is in the pot. So you don't want to plant them deeper or higher. And that's for vegetables. If you know better, like for tomatoes and some other plants, you can plant them deeper. It just makes them stronger. But in general, you just want to kind of keep them at the same level, because sometimes it'll go ahead and rot at the base and you'll lose your plant. So we're going to go ahead and I'm going to plant all this whole bed up, and then we're going to come back and talk a little bit more about weed control.
And it, when you look at me,
there's a place, not so far away, a place where you don't have to keep the volume down. You'll find all sorts of creatures in this place without have to. The silly you, the proud you. You may even meet the curious you.
It's tickling me!
You!
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 Ask your parents to take you to this not so far away place. Come to the forest, where the other you lives. But first, stop by discovertheforest.org.
Welcome back. You know, I'm the fastest planter on the planet. I don't really think a lot about it. I kind of learn from my mistakes. A lot of people fret too much about this planting thing. But then I kill, you know, lots of plants every year. No big deal to me. One of the things that I wanted to point out to you is that there's this big, huge space in the center for these tomato plants to utilize space. Also, you know, I've got a lot of stuff around the edges that I fully expect won't be able to compete, and I'm not worried about that. What I want is to be able to harvest these guys before the tomatoes take over the bed. So it's kind of like a layered way to do things. So, and then I have some of the bigger plants, that the basils and stuff, kind of further away from the tomato plants. The peppers are further away. And then one other thing to help kind of keep everybody to be happy citizens all together is to provide the tomatoes something to lean on, okay? Something to, a guide to stay into. Now, I talked to you about hybrid tomatoes, and they're great, and I don't have anything but nice things to say about them. The only thing is that they aren't good citizens. They have a tendency to sprawl. Wherever their branches touch the ground, they'll root, and so they will take over a large area. So one of the things you can do is get a tomato cage. These are reusable. So what you do is you just, while they're little guys, it's hard when they're big, it's just jam this around the edge. And then every once in a while, you're gonna come in and kind of lift these branches up so that it has a place to grow up, because they don't really wanna grow down. They're mostly vining plants. So you've got this nice cage. And then what you'll do, if you wanna be really, really diligent about it, you know, you can actually get tomato plants to produce more by pulling off some axillary buds, which involves coming in and finding the leader and taking out the little buds at the base of these leaves. And then that leader will, you'll end up with better growth up at the top and a lot better tomatoes. So now that I've got that on there, and I won't cage all the tomatoes because I don't have enough cages, but I'm going to go ahead and talk to you about mulches. Mulches are any kind of anything, doesn't matter, that covers the soil, prevents light from getting to the surface of the soil so seedlings can germinate. It prevents germinated weed seeds from coming up and thriving. A lot of times if they actually do make it through your mulch, then they're so weak that they're really easy to get rid of. And then it also keeps moisture in. And then at the end of the season, if you've used an organic mulch instead of, say, something like plastic, you can actually use that as organic matter, put it back in the soil. My favorite thing is hay or horse manure. Now, horse manure is not easily available, but you can buy straw, and sometimes you can go to the feed stores and pick up their loose hay. But when the biggest issue that people have with using straw as mulch is that they don't put enough down, okay? And I'm going to show you the difference between a well-mulched straw mulch and a really poor straw mulch. So I'm going to take a quick break again. I'm going to place this mulch down, and I'm going to do half of it really well and half of it poorly, and you can see the difference.
You promised me the world. Is this what you had in mind?
Every choice we make has a consequence. Help Earthshare and its members restore balance to the world. Visit earthshare.org and see what you can do. Earthshare, one environment, one simple way to care for it.
Okay, so here we are with our poorly mulched side and our well mulched side, and the difference doesn't look apparent unless you get up close. One of the things is you can see that I've got a big mat here that I've laid down and pulled right up to the base of the plant and pulled it apart, as opposed to this side where I can see a whole bunch of the soil. And that means that if I can see the soil, that means that the light's getting there, that means that the weeds are going to germinate into that. The advantage of this too is that because this straw is light colored, it will reflect a lot of the heat, and so the plants will actually get that heat reflected back up to them and they grow better. If you have plants that you're seeding into the ground, obviously mulching is not appropriate. You know, it just means that if you seed like radishes or carrots or something else, that you're going to have to actually weed those out before you mulch into it. So a lot of the small seeded, especially root crops, are things that you're going to have to spend a little bit of time weeding everything before you put the mulch down. But you know, it works really well for all kinds of things like zucchini and watermelons and cantaloupe and those kinds of things. But again, those, if you seed directly into the ground, which I recommend, that you're going to have to do some weeding. That's just all there is to it. But you can mulch all the way up to the area where you've seeded and wait, and once they've germinated, then you can use some of that mulch around the base again. So there's a lot of other things you can use. You can use wood mulch, and like I said, I'd mentioned hay. You can actually use organic mulch. You can get a lot of organic compost and put that down. But I like the straw because, again, it does reflect a lot of light and help out. It also keeps things warmer. Another nice thing about straw is that if you do plant early and you're not interested in going out and acquiring Walla Waters and spending that money or trying to reuse your Walla Waters, there's something you can do if there's a frost. You just grab a little bit of straw, and I'm just going to grab this out anyway. And you, let me pull this cage. And you just make your own little teepee, and that will prevent your tomato plant from frosting. And then if it's not, then all you have to do in the morning is go like this, and you're all done. No filling up water, no squeezing out water, no nothing. No worrying about plastic bags blowing away. I live out in Washoe Valley. I've had my Walla Waters blow. It's amazing to me. So I think straw is actually nicer in general. I like straw, and it's organic too, and it's easier to deal with. So again, I'd like to thank you for joining Let's Grow. It's always fun to have you guys around. If you're interested in the community garden, again, the number is 334-2270. You can ask for Dianne or Davine. We do have a waiting list this year, but next year we'll be starting again. And I always need volunteers in the Rose Garden and other places. So if you're interested in volunteering, it's the same number. So I think it's going to be a great year for gardening. And just enjoy yourself. Don't take it too seriously. And thank you for joining Let's Grow.